I would like to tell you now how to use a simple clock to explain the planetary aspects like orbital period, synodic period, sidereal period, and so on. So this is a very simple gadget that you all can have access to very easily. So the angle between the two hands of the clock is 180 degrees. So the question that I pose to the students is, when will it repeat? When will the angle between the two hands be 180 degrees again? The answer that I get will be varied. Sometimes they say 6 hours, sometimes they say 12 hours, sometimes they say 24 hours. But after a little prompting, they will come out with the right answer, namely 65 minutes. So how did they get 65 minutes? Because they know that this is 12 hours and this is 1 hour. So you have three periodicities now. One is a 12-hour periodicity, one is a 1-hour periodicity, and the other is a 65-minute periodicity, which is the time of overlap. So if you know any of two of these, you can find the third. So let us now try to understand how to get the orbital periods of planets with this, or even to get other concepts. So the easiest will be to understand the sidereal time. What is sidereal time? So let us say I'll put the sun at the end of this, and then I'll put the star at the end, any star at the end of this. In which case, you know that the sun comes back to the meridian after 24 hours, whereas the star will make it 4 minutes earlier. And this is containing the hidden idea that the earth is going around the sun. Then we can extend it to the moon. So what will I do? I'll put the sun here and I'll put the moon here. So this is the position of the full moon. So when will the full moon repeat again? That is easy to observe. So you know that it is 29.53 days. And the sun, we assume that the sun is going around the earth with a period of 365.25 days. And therefore, you can use these two periodicities to get another one, which is the sidereal orbital period of the moon, which works out 27.32 days. So this is how you are able to get it. Now we can use the same idea for the planets also. So let us say I'll put Mars here and the sun here. So this will be corresponding to the opposition, which means that the Earth is here, sun here, and Mars here. So what is the time needed for this to occur again? You can observe this in the sky and find that that periodicity is 780 days. It takes 365 days for the sun to go around the Earth, 780 days for this to happen. So you can find the third period, which is the orbital period of Mars. Now, I have been giving the example of 180 degrees. Instead of 180 degrees, I can take the angle to be 45 degrees also. Okay, 45 degrees. If the angle is 45 degrees also, it works, because when will it be 45 degrees again? Same, 65 minutes. So whether you take 0, whether you take 180, or whether you take 45, it's the same. 45 I mentioned because the maximum elongation of Venus is about 47 degrees. So we keep observing Venus for the maximum elongation, note down the date, and then wait for another similar 47 degrees thing to happen. At that time, note down the date. That means the interval between the successive overlaps is available. So out of the three periodicities, you know, one is 365, the other is the 200 odd days, and therefore you get the orbital period of Venus. So this way you can do it for various applications. For example, if you are standing on Mercury, Mercury has a peculiar periodicity. And so what, one day will be equal to 1.5 years. So how to explain that? That also you can use this gadget for explaining it. And some students come up with a newer idea. So it will be a very interesting gadget for discussion in the classroom. Now I'll share the same though. The idea is to use the clock as a teaching aid. And this is the formula I mentioned. So this is the formula I mentioned. T is the period of overlap, and capital T is the orbital period of one, and the other is the T dash. So now you have all the three values here, and so you can verify easily how you get 65 minutes. So the first example I chose is that of a star. Here is a star and here is another star, and one period is 56 minutes, the other is 24 hours. So you will get an overlapping period. Interestingly, this turns out to be 365 days or so. With the right decimal number of decimal points, we'll get the answer, which reflects the orbital motion of the Earth around the Sun. The sidereal time usually explained like this. So it is the same thing that has been converted into the clock here. This is the same sidereal explanation. This is the explanation I gave for Moon. Instead of the star, I'm now having the Moon. So this is the full moon, the angle is 180 degrees, and after 29.53 days, you will have the overlap again. And therefore, if you put that in the formula, you will get a T dash, which is 27.32 days, which is the sidereal orbital period of the moon. And we do it for Mars. This is the opposition of Mars. So here you have 1 by T is equal to some 780 days, and T is 365.25 days, so you can find out T dash, which is the orbital period of Mars. So 780 days and 365.25 days. And you measure this angle and then use this idea of periodicity for getting the same answer. You use the same formula, so you get the orbital period of Venus. And this is the meaning of greatest elongation of Venus. You know that you can get the orbital period by another method also. That is, you can use that for verifying it. Now, this is what I meant when I said Mercury, 1 day is equal to 1.5 year. So here again, you imagine yourself to be positioned here on the surface of the Mercury. And then because it has a different period and orbital days, when will the Sun be at your zenith? So you are the person. Which is the reference here. You represent one hand of the clock. The Sun represents the other hand of the clock. So you are finding out the interval of when will the Sun be at your zenith again. And in case of Venus, you have yet another possibility, 224.65 days as the rotation period, 242 days as the revolution period. So there you will get a completely different answer. And it's fun working it out. And, we extended the same idea to have a huge clock built on our wall. This is about 3 meters. And here we have incorporated not only the angle, but the idea of the phase also. So this was on July 22nd when it was almost gibbous. So you cannot make out the phase here, but let me show you the next two examples. So on August 2nd, the moon is here. The moon was almost gibbous, but it was in the evening sky. And on August 11th, the moon was crescent, but it was in the sky at dawn. All such concepts can be explained by the use of this simple mechanism of the clock. So this is what I felt is a very useful device for teaching in the classrooms. I suppose you can implement this without much problem. And this is my suggestion.
The exhibit I found very useful for teaching as well as for popularization programs of astronomy. As you know, all the models that we have created and we explain on the board are all made in the horizontal plane. And the first thing that the students find it difficult to understand is that how this gets transformed into the real sky in the vertical plane. Therefore, I got this model made so that I can put the observer here representing me or the student to be standing here. So if this is his position on the Earth, the whole thing is not to scale, but he can realize that the Sun is at the zenith, so this has to be noon. Therefore, when he rotates and goes here, it is going to be sunset and the Sun is at the horizon. To explain this, we need to explain the concept of horizon, which is a plane tangential to the Earth. Therefore, this is the plane which is tangential and the observer is standing here. And this also will help me to explain which half of the celestial sphere is visible, which half is not visible. So for example, if there is a star above the Sun, that star is not visible. But when it is setting, when the Sun is setting, that star also is setting. But what happens 6 months later? 6 months later, the position of the observer will be here, and therefore when the person is standing here, the sun is at the zenith, but when he moves on to the other side here, that particular star which was not visible 6 months ago is now visible. So this way we will be able to explain the visibility of constellations, visibility of the planets. If I want to explain the moon, I can simply put the moon here and explain that this is new moon and that is full moon, and the full moon is near a particular star in that particular month. And similarly, I can go to any other position and explain. See, when it is here, it is some other star in this direction, and so on. So this model has been very useful for explaining all concepts of positional astronomy. And we have made this motorized also, so that it can be used as an exhibit also. It shows rotation as well as revolution, but not to scale.